This is ACN.
My topic tonight is Revelation Reveals Deadly Delusions. Probably one subject that the Christian church has become more confused over than any other single topic is this whole subject of death. The question is often asked, what happens when you die? Can we find hope that goes beyond the grave? More and more people in their middle age are losing their elderly parents, and they watch as their parents are kept alive on life support, and they watch as their parents are dying, like Tina. Tina's father was dying. She had left the faith of her childhood, and so she came to his grave, rather came to his bedside first, and sat there and watched him die. And as she did, there were many perplexing thoughts in her mind. Is there any hope after death? What does life beyond the grave really bring? What happens 5 minutes after death? Tina had walked away from the faith of her childhood. There was little to buttress her, little to support her at the time of death. She was a very intelligent young woman, but yet all of her intellect could not provide peace at the time of her father's death. And as she walked through the cemetery to his grave, wondering about what happened after death, these questions that were so prevalent in her mind, that raced around in her head, led her on a search to understand the truth from God's word. Because the truth of the matter is, the question can be answered. The question of what really happens at death has a solid biblical answer. Now, I recognize that even Christians and non-Christians look at this subject of death differently. If you would ask some of our lovely Roman Catholic friends what happens when you die, most of them would say, when you die, a person has a soul that goes to heaven or hell. At death, if you've been good, you go to heaven. The traditional viewpoint is, if you're bad, you go to hell. Hell's some hot spot in the center of the earth that's burning all the time. That's what many people teach. Our Catholic friends would say, if you're not quite good enough to go to heaven or bad enough to go to hell, you'll go to a place called purgatory, which is between heaven and hell, until you suffer and your sins are burned up and consumed, and then finally you go on to heaven. If you ask most Protestants what the alternatives are, they'll say, well, when you die, your soul goes to heaven or to hell. But then you'll go to some Protestant funerals. And when you go to the funeral, the preacher will say, well, the person is awaiting the resurrection. When Jesus comes, then a little later, he'll say his soul's in heaven. And so you kind of confuse. You say, where is he? Is he in the ground waiting for the resurrection when Jesus comes? Or is he up in heaven already? And if he's in heaven, does a soul have eyes? Can a soul speak? Does it have mouths? A mouth? Does it have ears? And if a soul has eyes and a mouth and ears, and it can speak and you can see it up in heaven, why does it have to come back for the body? So there's all kind of confusing questions, and people are really perplexed about this subject of death. This subject of, is it heaven? Is it hell? Is it nothingness? There's many an atheist that says our physical body is all that there is, and that when you die, you go into the grave and that's it. Over, kaput, finished, complete, final. You're in the grave, that's it. If you ask some of our Middle Eastern friends, our Indian friends particularly, our Hindu friends, they will say you die and you fulfill your karma. You come back in reincarnation or in transmigration. You may come back as a cow. You may come back as a servant. But you'll come back as something so that you can learn the lessons that you failed to learn in life. Catholics have one view. Protestants have another view. Atheists have another view. Hindus and varying world religions have another view. And some people say, I just give up. Is death the end totally? Now, there is one thing certain. The Bible very clearly answers these questions. And the whole question focuses around one issue. Is the soul immortal? Or is it that there is no such thing as the immortal soul, and human beings sleep until the resurrection? You see, if the soul is immortal, then it could either go to heaven or hell immediately at death. If the soul is immortal, then if you die and there's an immortal soul, the dead could actually talk to the living. If the soul is immortal, that gives way to the Indian idea, the possibility of the transmigration or reincarnation. See, this whole issue of death has to do with who has immortality, when will that immortality be given to us? Could it be, is it possible that the devil has a plan in the last days, a deadly delusion for people who believe this idea of the immortal soul? Where did that ever come from? But could the devil try to masquerade as our dead loved ones and try to deceive us? You know, where can we find some real answers? There are many books today that are being published on the subject of life after death, Journey into the Light, Life After Life, Betty Eddy's book called Embraced by the Light, The Great Awakening. These books are just exploding. Books on near-death experiences have catapulted to the bestseller status. Many of these books believe that it's possible for a person to die, enter into an immortal state, and come back. Many of them indicate they believe that the dead can actually communicate with the living. Spiritualism is exploding, particularly among people who have a secular bent, who rule out the Bible, who rule out Jesus, and these people believe that when you die, there's kind of an immortal essence that can communicate with the living. Would you agree with me tonight, ladies and gentlemen, that the only reliable place to find information about death or any subject is the Bible? Would you agree with me tonight that we can turn from the popular books that are written by popular authors on the subject of death, even if they were written by popular preachers, and that we can go exactly to the Word of God, we can lay aside our preconceived ideas, we can lay aside our prejudices, we can come with a blank sheet of paper and say, God, I want my mind to be secure. I don't want to be deceived by Satan's deadly delusions of spiritualism in the last days. I want to know what God's Word teaches. Revelation teaches something fundamentally about death. This revelation of Jesus Christ reveals in Revelation 1, verse 18. Jesus says, read it with me, please. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Christ went into the grave. Christ came out of the grave and was resurrected physically and bodily. Jesus went into the grave with a body that was subject to suffering and pain. On the cross, the nails brought Jesus pain. The crown of thorns upon his head brought him pain. The spear lashes on his back brought him pain. He had a physical body that could have pain. He was subject to hunger. He had a physical body. But when he came out of the tomb, he was clothed with a glorious immortal body. The Bible says that Jesus was resurrected. Then it goes on to say, and I have the keys of hell and of death. The reason we need not fear death is because Christ conquered death. On the cross, Jesus Christ paid the penalty for sin, and the wages of sin is death. Because Jesus went into the grave and came out. Because he has the keys of the grave, any believer who dies and rests in Jesus can look forward to that resurrection. The entire Bible teaches us about the resurrection. It points forward to the second coming of Christ when Jesus comes and the dead are resurrected. But somebody says, what does the Bible teach about this whole subject of the soul? What does it teach about the idea of the immortal soul? We've been looking at the book of Revelation, the book of endings. Let's go back to the book of beginnings, because all the books of the Bible meet and end in the book of Revelation. So we go to the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, that book of beginnings. And maybe we can learn something about how God created human beings so that we can learn something about what happens when they die. Genesis 2, verse 7 says, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Now notice what happens. The Lord God forms man out of the dust of the ground. So God is forming Adam out of the dust. That's the body. Then the Bible says he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. It doesn't say that God breathed the soul into human beings. He formed his body out of the dust of the ground, breathed into his body the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now, does the Bible say that God put an immortal soul in Adam? Does it say that? No. The Bible says God formed him out of the dust of the ground, that's body. God breathed into his life his power, and man became a living what? Soul. So we might put it this way. Dust plus spirit in that text equals a what? Living soul. Or we could put it this way. The elements of earth plus the breath equal a living soul. God breathed his spirit into man, or God put his breath. In the Bible, spirit and breath are the exact same thing. So we can put it this way then. A living soul means a living person. God created the body out of the dust of the earth. God breathed into that body the breath or his spirit. Man became a living soul or a living being, a living person. What is this soul? Is it immortal, or can the soul ever die? The Bible is very plain on this point. Ezekiel 18, verse 4, "Behold, all souls are mine, as the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine." Read it together with me, please. "The soul that sinneth, it shall die." Can the soul die according to the Bible? Yes, because it says, "The soul that sinneth, it shall what? Die." There is another name for soul in the Bible that surprises some people, and that is person or life. For example, if you look at today's English version, it says, "The person who sins is the one who will die." The older translations say, "The soul that sins." So the soul is the person. The soul is the combination of breath and body. It's the combination of the dust of the earth and the Spirit of God. I am a living soul, or I'm a living person. Look at, for example, the Living Bible. "It is for a man's own sins that he will die." The other translation says, "The soul that sinneth." Some says, "The person that sins." Some says, "He will die." The New American Standard Bible puts it this way: "The soul, parentheses, person who sins will die." We use it that way sometimes, don't we? Let's suppose a lady goes to the store and she comes home a half an hour earlier than her husband thought she was going to come home. And he said, "My, you're home quick, darling. I expected you another half an hour later." And she says, "Oh, there was not a soul there." He says, "It's a good thing there wasn't a soul there. You'd have been scared out of your wits." No, he understands what she means, right? There wasn't a soul there. There wasn't a what? Person there. The Bible uses the word soul to mean person or life, not an immortal conscious entity that leaves the body at death. Now listen to this. The Bible uses the word soul 1,600 times, and never once does it use the word immortal soul. If you are able to find the phrase immortal soul in the Bible, I will offer you $1,000. If you look and don't find it, you pay me $1,000. Right? I knew I could get some money for "It is written" one way or the other. Is that fair enough? Those of you who believe the immortal soul, any pastor, you tell your pastor that. If he can find you the expression in the Bible, immortal soul, okay? Immortal soul. In the King James Version of the Bible, okay? I will give him $1,000. If he fails, he will give "It is written" a check for $1,000. Or else he doesn't preach that anymore, if it's not in the Bible. Ezekiel 18, verse 4. The soul, the person who sins, will what? die. New American Standard version of the Bible. Now notice, soul is life. Matthew 16, 25, for whoever desires to save his life will what? Lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. So it's talking about saving your life and losing your life. Then it goes on to say what? For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his what? Soul or his what? Life. You've got it. Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul or his what? Life. So in the Bible, there is no such thing in the Bible of immortal soul. Only God is immortal in the Bible. Mortal means subject to death. Immortal means imperishable. The Bible never uses the terms immortal soul or the immortality of the soul. In fact, when the Bible talks about the term immortality, this is how it uses it. 1 Timothy 1, verse 17. Read it with me, please. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. So the King is immortal. God is immortal. We receive immortality when Christ comes. The Bible says, this mortal shall put on immortality. When I come to Jesus Christ, he gives me the gift of eternal life. That dwells in my heart right now. But the gift of immortality, to receive an immortal body, to be ascended up into the air with Christ, that comes at the second coming of Jesus. So the Bible says, now to the King eternal, immortal. Only God is immortal. In fact, in 1 Timothy 6, verse 15, the Bible says, he who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, who, next word, what is it? What is it? Alone has immortality, dwelling in the unapproachable light. Now, if I am the only one who has my wallet, if I alone have my wallet, that must indicate that what? You don't have it. At least I hope you don't. You don't have it, right? So the Bible says regarding immortality, who alone has immortality? Who is that? The one that dwells in the unapproachable light, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In this text, it's talking about Jesus is immortal. So Job says in Job 4:17, shall mortal man be more just than his maker? So human beings, we are mortal. According to Romans 2:7, we seek for immortality. So immortality is something we never have in our present condition. Now, where did the idea of the immortality of the soul come from? The Christians always believed in the resurrection. The pagan Greek philosophy taught that the soul is immortal. You see, the Greeks taught that the body and the soul are two different things. That when a person dies, the body goes to the earth, but the Greeks say the soul leaves the body at death. That was a Greek idea. The Christians say, no, when a person dies, it's like a rest or a sleep, resting in the arms of Christ, secure in Jesus, resting from the heartbreak and sorrow and disappointment from earth until that glorious resurrection. And that's what the Apostle Paul meant when he said, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, this mortal shall put on immortality, this corruptible shall be raised in corruption. See, what the Apostle Paul said is that death is this momentary sleep. It's this perfect peace. It is the twinkling of an eye. The next instant, the next thing you know, is the coming of Jesus. Pagan Greek philosophy taught that the soul is immortal. Spiritualism today teaches that the soul is immortal. Spiritualism teaches that you die, but there's this essence of you that lives on, and it can come back and communicate with the living. Do you see why this is such a deadly idea? Because Satan can use this for dead loved ones to masquerade before their loved ones who are living. I remember I was teaching on the subject of death on the lovely islands of the Philippines. I was down in Legazpi City, there by the perfect, most perfect cone-shaped volcano in the world, the Mayon Volcano. And one night, as I was preaching, I talked about the subject of death. I taught that death was but a sleep in the Bible. I taught that death was a rest until the resurrection, till when Christ comes. I read from the Bible in the book of Job, that a person cannot return to their house. I read about how Satan masquerades as an angel of light with deceptions, trying to deceive the living regarding their dead. There was a Filipino colonel who came to our meetings in the army. His wife had died about 6 months before. A few nights after my lecture, there was a very terrible storm in that city. A typhoon came through, rain was pelting down, and as it was, he was lying in his bed and he looked up and he saw this gorgeous form of his wife. Like she was in her younger years, spiritualistic form, she reached out and she said, "Oh, honey, I want to embrace you, I want to kiss you." He looked up and he remembered those texts in Job that say that the dead can't return to their house. He remembered that death is a sleep until the glorious resurrection. He remembered all that. He looked up and he said, "You are not my wife. You're an evil angel masquerading as my wife. In the name of Jesus, be gone." And he said, "Pastor, before my eyes, I saw a dark, shadowy form, and that form disappeared because in the name of Jesus, all demons must be gone." Ladies and gentlemen, spiritualism teaches that the soul is indeed immortal. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51 says, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all," what everybody? "Sleep, but we shall all be changed." When are we going to be changed? In a moment. See, it's a sleep, but it's only a moment. We die, and you don't have any passage of time in sleep. When you die, it's just resting. Just like when you go to sleep tonight. If you're a sound sleeper, you rest, and you don't know that you went to sleep at 10 o'clock or 11, and it's 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in the morning. You don't know that unless you're awake. But sleep is this perfect state of bliss until the coming of the Lord. It's in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the what? Last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised, what? Incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. Verse 54 and onward says, "Then this mortal must put on immortality." When God created Adam, he placed his breath within Adam, not an immortal soul. God created Adam, and there breathed his breath or his life into Adam. Notice Genesis 2:7, God formed man of the dust of the ground, breathed into his nostrils the breath or the power of life. Man becomes a living soul or a living being. Now, death is creation in reverse. Death is creation in reverse. What happens when a person dies? What is it that goes back to God? Ecclesiastes 12, verse 7 says, "Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the what? Spirit shall return to God who gave it." Does the Bible say the soul goes back to God? It says what goes back to God? The spirit. So the body goes to the dust. But this spirit that goes back to God is not something that's conscious. It is the breath or power of God that returns to God, and God has preserved the identity of that person in his mind. The Old Testament Hebrew word for spirit is ruach. I've given you the phonetic pronunciation, or the phonetic spelling, not the literal Hebrew spelling. The Old Testament Hebrew word for spirit is ruach. It means breath. So spirit and breath are the same thing, not spirit and soul. See, a lot of people get confused. They think the spirit and the soul are the same thing. Not so. God forms man out of the dust of the ground. That's his body. God breathes into man his ruach, his spirit or his breath. Man becomes a living soul. When a person dies, the body goes to the dust. The spirit or breath of life, the power of life, goes back to God. Now notice how the Bible teaches that the breath and spirit are the same thing. Job 27:3, "All the while my breath is in me, and the what? Spirit of God is in my nostrils." Well, what's in your nostrils? Is that something that breathes every time you go like that? Is that something that breathes and thinks and reasons? No, that's the breath that God gives you. Every heartbeat comes from God. Every pulse comes from God. So he says, "My breath is in me. The Spirit of God is in my nostrils." In other words, the power that God gives me to live. James 2, verse 26 says, "The body without the what? Spirit or the breath is what? Dead." Maybe I can illustrate it this way. Let's suppose that here is a light bulb, and that's illumination. Now, to get illumination, I need a bulb. The bulb represents the body. But if I'm going to have illumination or light, I need somebody to plug in the light bulb. The light bulb alone doesn't give me light. I need power, correct? So the power represents God's spirit or God's breath. The power or breath comes through the cord into the bulb, and that produces what? Illumination. Would somebody please turn off that light for me? Thank you very much. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what happens when you unplug the light? What happens? The power goes where? Back to the powerhouse. So when God unplugs our breath and we die, the power to create life is where? With God. So the power to create life is with God. The body, the bulb, goes to the dust. There is no illumination, or the person does not live as a living soul. Breath goes back to God, body goes to the dust. Now, is there any conscious existence in death? What does the Bible teach about is there any conscious existence? Psalm 146, verse 4 says, his spirit departs, he returns to his earth. In that very day, his plans, another translation say, his thoughts perish. They perish. Ecclesiastes 9, verse 5, read it with me, please. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing. How much do the dead know? Nothing. Why not? The Spirit of God has gone back to God. The breath has returned to God. The body has gone to the dust. They are resting, secure. The Bible says, the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything. They're waiting for that moment, that twinkling of an eye. Ecclesiastes 9:6 says, also their love, their hatred, and their envy have now perished. Why, look, if the soul went to heaven when you died, at least there would be love to love God. But the Bible says their love and their hatred, their envy, have now perished. Why? Because they are not in a conscious existence. They are sleeping. The Bible teaches that death is a sleep that lasts until Christ's second coming. Bible writers declare death a sleep more than 50 times. Look, for example, throughout the Old Testament. Psalm 13, verse 3 says, consider and hear me, O Lord my God. Enlighten mine eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of what? Death. So in the Bible, death is a sleep. In the Bible, death is a rest. In the Bible, there is no immortal soul. 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1, now the days of David drew near that he should what? Die. But then the Bible says, so David rested with his fathers and was buried in the city of David. 1 Kings 2, verse 10. The Bible says that David rested with his fathers. Death is a rest or a sleep. Jesus, you remember, was talking about death to his disciples. And as he was traveling one day to visit Lazarus. Lazarus was very sick, and Lazarus had died. Jesus waited 3 days before he ever went to the home. While they were on their way, Jesus made this statement. John 11, verse 11. He said, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up. Jesus said, our friend Lazarus is sleeping. The disciples said, Lord, then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well. See, they thought that Jesus was speaking about Lazarus being sick, then falling asleep in the evening, and thus he would wake up in the morning and feel better. Jesus went on. However, Jesus spoke of his what? Death. But they thought that he was speaking about taking a rest in sleep. Jesus first said Lazarus is sleeping, then Jesus said Lazarus is what? Dead. So for Jesus, death is but a sleep. Jesus then visited Lazarus' home and decided to raise him from the dead as a demonstration of his power that he could raise any human being from death. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is what, everybody? Dead. As Jesus got to the home, Jesus speaks to Martha in John 11, verse 23. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Now notice the words very carefully. Jesus didn't say to Martha, Martha, good news. Martha, praise God. Martha, don't cry because Lazarus' soul is up in heaven. Is that what Jesus said to Martha? Not at all. Jesus said, your brother is sleeping first. Then he said, your brother is dead. Then he said, don't worry, your brother's going to rise again in the last day. I would rather get my religion from Jesus than accept a high-bred pagan philosophy that has entered the Christian church through the Greeks. Jesus said, Lazarus is sleeping. Jesus said, Lazarus is dead. Jesus said, Lazarus will rise on the last day. He'll be resurrected. Now, Martha learned her religion directly from Jesus. What did Martha believe about death? Did she believe that Lazarus was in heaven? Let's listen to Martha's own words. John 11, verse 24. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection. When? At the last day. What was Martha expecting? She was expecting that Lazarus would be resurrected from the dead in the resurrection when Jesus Christ came again in the last day. Then Jesus said to Martha, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. Jesus says, I'm the resurrection and the life. I will go into the grave after the cross and come out. And as a demonstration that death cannot hold its victims, as a demonstration that Jesus can wipe away every tear from your eye at the funerals, Jesus said, you need not be filled with sorrow and grief because there is a resurrection at the last day. We can see our dead loved ones again. They are sleeping. They are secure. Believers are resting in God's love and care. He's marked that tomb. He has a record of their identity in his mind. And Christ will come and raise them from the dead. And the proof of that, the evidence of that, is the resurrection of Lazarus. So Jesus came to that tomb and he said, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus came out of the grave alive. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's suppose that Jesus came to that grave, and what many people believe is true, Lazarus was up in heaven. Jesus would have said, Lazarus, come down. Now, I'll tell you something. If I were Lazarus, and I had been up there for three, 4 days, and Jesus said, come down, I'd have looked down and said, nothing doing, Lord. I am not coming back there. Right? I mean, wouldn't you have... I mean, if what people believe is true, we should have a whole book on heaven from a man called Lazarus in the Bible. If what people believe is true, Lazarus should have wrote a book in the Bible, should have written a book in the Bible. I knew my English teacher would get me on that, not wrote, but written. All right. If what many people believe is true, we should have a whole book in the Bible written by Lazarus about the glories of heaven. But Lazarus was silent about heaven. Why? Because he was sleeping until the resurrection, exactly like Jesus said, and exactly like Martha believed, exactly like our dead loved ones. Ladies and gentlemen, it is a wonderful thing to know that God has marked the grave of that husband or wife, that child, that father, that mother, to know that the heartaches of earth that they were so troubled with are over for them, to know that the suffering that they went through because of cancer is over for them, to know that they are just as if they were cradled in Christ's arms in a perfect state of bliss and sleep until the resurrection. The Bible puts it so beautifully when it says in Job 14, verse 21, if his sons are honored, he does not know it. If they are brought low, he does not see it. I've had people say to me, oh, Pastor, I love to think of my mother up in heaven looking down at me. But look, what if you have a husband who abuses you and your mother's up in heaven and he's watching that abuse and she's watching that abuse? What if a mother dies and she's up in heaven and has a 13-year-old kid who runs out in front of a car and gets hit and she has to see that? What if a mother's up in heaven and a guy's drafted into the war and he's caught by the enemy and they gouge out his eyes, you see? What if a mother's up in heaven and her kid goes astray and he's shooting drugs in his veins and he's ruining his life? God is too merciful for that. He's too merciful. You die And it's a perfect rest, a perfect state of bliss. You don't know any passage of time. It is a period of bliss until the resurrection, when Christ comes and wakes you up and says, now all the sorrow is over. Now all the heartache is over. Now all the disappointment is over. That's why the Bible says in Psalm 115, verse 17, please read it with me, the dead do not praise the Lord, nor any who go down into silence. The Bible says the dead, what everybody? Do not praise the Lord. If they were up in heaven, what would they be doing? Praising the Lord. 1,600 times in the Bible, never once, immortal soul. 53 times the Bible says death is but a sleep. The Bible talks about the resurrection. It talks about the coming of Christ. It talks about the graves being opened. The Bible is very plain on this subject of death. Jesus Christ himself says, Colossians chapter 3, verse 3, for you died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When we die, all the demons in hell cannot cause us to be lost. When we die, our genuine identity, our genuine life is hid with Christ in God. And when Christ comes, notice, Colossians 3, verse 4, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will appear with him where? In glory. When that loved one died as a believer, their life was hidden with Christ in God. He's preserved their true identity. They sleep. There is no passage of time. They don't know about the trouble of the kids. They don't know about the heartache of their brother and sister. They don't know about the trauma their wife faces. That man, that woman dies. They don't know about the trauma of their husband or their wife. They are sleeping. There is no passage of time. Christ comes as Christ comes. Our life has been hid with Christ in God. He calls John, come forth. He calls Mary, come forth. The graves are open. We're caught up to meet Jesus in the air. And as we are, we ascend to him. The Christ who died on the cross, the Christ that went into the grave, has redeemed us. He came out of the grave. Revelation says he has the keys of the grave. The grave cannot hold God's children. And Jesus comes. The resurrection occurs, and they're delivered. But somebody says, Pastor, wait a minute. When Jesus was dying on the cross, didn't he say to the thief, today you'll be with me in paradise? You know, it's rather fascinating to me. You can read 1,600 texts in the Bible that say, no immortal soul, never once. You can read 53 texts, death is asleep. You can read Psalm 6, verse 5, the dead praise not the Lord. You can read Ecclesiastes 9, 5, the living know that they shall die, but the dead know not anything. You can read Psalm 6, verse 5, that says, in the grave there is no remembrance of you. You can read text after text after text. You can read 1 Thessalonians 4 that talks about the resurrection and comforting one another with the words of the resurrection. And then somebody says, but wait a minute, Pastor, what about the thief on the cross? Now let's recapture that story. There was a thief on a cross. In fact, there were two thieves and one Christ. And the thief on the left looked over at Jesus and he said, Jesus, if you're the Son of God, come down off the cross. And the other thief spoke up and he said, in essence, what he said is, calm down, be quiet. This man is the Son of God. I've seen him. Forgive sins. My heart's been moved and touched. And then that thief looked over at Jesus, and this is what he said. The thief said to Jesus, remember me when you come into the kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today you'll be with me in paradise. Somebody says, there it is. There it is. It all depends on where you put that comma. You see, there it says, and Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today you'll be with me in paradise. But what if the comma were moved? Let's just move the comma and see the change. If you move the comma, it would read differently. And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise. See, it all makes a difference where you put the comma. See, if you put the comma after today, it's like Jesus is saying, assuredly, I say to you today, this day that I'm dying on the cross, this day that it looks like I can't save anybody, this day that blood is running down my face, this day that I'm dying as a common criminal, even today, I assure you that you'll be with me in paradise. Now, most of you are aware that commas were not put in the New Testament Bible until the 13 and 1400s. In the original language, there were no commas. Where you put commas makes a big difference. For example, what if I read this sentence, a woman without her man is nothing? Then I just put a couple of commas in. A woman without her man is nothing. I knew the ladies would like that one. I knew it. Does it make any difference, ladies, where you put that comma? Gentlemen, do you want me to move the comma? Hey, some guy said, yes, your wife will talk to you about that later, sir. You see, it really makes a difference. Punctuation makes a difference. How do we know where the comma should be placed in that previous passage? Here's the way you know. First, passages in the Bible don't contradict one another. When God says 53 times that death is asleep, when God says 1,600 times, no immortal soul, when the Bible says the living know that they shall die, but the dead don't know anything, you know that you have to place the comma correctly in the passage. You know you have to put it with the bulk of Scripture. But there's another reason. It is doubtful that the thief even died that day. Because you remember, the Bible says that the Roman soldiers came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, so they didn't what? Break his legs. But they came to the first thief and the second thief, and they broke their legs because they were not what? Dead. Often. And that was because the Sabbath was coming, and the Jewish leader said, take them off the cross. Often, it took 4 or 5 days for a person to die from crucifixion. The thieves were alive, the sun was setting, the day was going to be over that day, Friday. And so they broke their legs, and often they broke their legs so they wouldn't run away. They took them in this emaciated, half-dead condition off the cross, threw them on a human garbage heap, and let them die there rather than keep their bodies on the cross over the Sabbath. There is no clear text in the Bible that says the thief died that day. But wait a minute. Did Christ himself go to paradise that day? Let's let Jesus answer. You remember the first day of the week, Jesus was crucified on Friday, rested in the tomb on Sabbath. But the first day of the week, Mary was out at the tomb. Jesus looked through the mist. He saw Mary. Her eyes met him. She didn't realize it was the Christ. She thought it was the gardener. Jesus said to her in John 20, verse 15, Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? And she, supposing him to be the gardener, John 20, verse 15, said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, that is, if you've taken the Christ away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. That is, I'll embalm his body. Jesus said to her, Mary. Now, nobody could say the name of the Savior like that. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him, Rabboni, which is to say, teacher. When Jesus called Mary's name, she heard in the way the Savior enunciated her name, in the way he pronounced her name. She said, that is the Lord. That's the Lord. And she said, Master. She ran to him. And Jesus said to her, read it with me, please. Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. But what does he say? Go to my brethren and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. When Jesus was crucified on Friday, he rested in the tomb sleeping on Sabbath. He was resurrected on the first day of the week, and he said, now I'm ascending to the Father. How could Christ have said to the thief on Friday that he would be meet him in paradise that day when Jesus himself didn't even go till Sunday, the first day of the week? You see, it's impossible. So what did Jesus mean when he said to the thief, I will be with you in paradise? Jesus said, I say unto you today, this day that I'm dying on the cross, this day that I have been stripped from my power, apparently, this day when men and women are ridiculing me, this day with the blood running from my face, this day with a crown of thorns on my head, this day that it doesn't look like I can save anybody, I say to you, this day, you will be with me one day in paradise. because I'm going to be resurrected from the dead. And as I ascend to heaven, your name is written on my hand. As I ascend to heaven, I will ascend there with your name on my lips. As I ascend to heaven, the tomb will be empty, and because of my resurrection, you can be resurrected one day too. Oh, death, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 55. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, or Hades, another word for grave. Oh, grave, where is your victory? Thanks be to God, 1 Corinthians 15, 57, who gives us the victory. Through who? Our Lord Jesus Christ. Have you lost a husband or a wife or a loved one by death? Do you sometimes go to that grave of your father or your child or your brother and kneel there and put flowers there? The good news is that death has lost its sting. The good news is that death has lost its hold. The good news is the grave cannot hold us because Jesus Christ went into the grave. He came out of the grave. Our life is hid with Christ in God. Our identity is solid in Christ. Our name is on his lips. He's written pardon on the palms of his hands. And when he comes again, he will say, John, come forth. He will say, Mary, come forth. He will say, Edmund, come forth. He will say, Sally, come forth. He will say, Mary Lou, come forth. Amanda, come forth. He will say, Joseph, come forth. Peter, come forth. When Christ comes, he knows your name. He calls your name. That dead loved one comes out of the grave. Look at what the Bible says in Revelation chapter 20, verse 6. Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power. The second death is eternal death. There is no real death for the believer. See, death is only a figment of human imagination. We die, but we sleep as believers until the coming of Christ. So it is only death from a human standpoint, not death from God's standpoint. Because our life is hid with Christ in God. A record of our life is preserved in God. And so we may die that first death, but it's not final. It's not universal. It is not an eternal death. Because the Bible says, blessed and holy is he who has part in the what? First resurrection. Jesus will come. He'll stream down the court of the sky. The earth will be illuminated with the glory of God. The dead will be resurrected and receive new, glorious, immortal bodies. And with the living, they'll be caught up to meet Christ in the air. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 says, for the Lord himself will descend from heaven. With a what? Shout. The shout of victory. The shout of triumph. The shout of glory. With the voice of an archangel. And with the trumpet of God. The trumpet blast that sin and sickness and death are over. And the dead in Christ will do what? Rise first. If we're already in heaven with Christ, why do you have this glorious event at the second coming of Christ? If souls can live in heaven without a body for thousands of years, why come and get the body at the second coming of Christ? It doesn't seem to make sense. But all of the Bible flows. All of the Bible moves. All the Bible is consistent to one great, glorious, climactic event. Why do Christians and why have Christians down through the ages long for the second coming of Christ? Why have Christians longed for Jesus to break through the sky and illuminate it with his glory? Why? Because these Christians through the ages, along with you and me, have believed that at that point the dead would be resurrected, we would receive glorious immortal bodies, and we would be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. Notice 1 Thessalonians 4:17. Then we who are alive and remain to the coming of Christ shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus, we shall always be with the Lord when Jesus comes, streaming down the sky. The dead are resurrected. Glorious immortal bodies. That son that you've laid in the grave, you can see again. That father that dies of cancer, you can see again. That mother that you've lost, you can embrace again. Together, we're caught up to meet Christ in the sky. Think of the excitement. Think of the thrill that flows through our bodies and pulsates in our bodies. Here, a husband and wife are alive. They're caught up to meet Christ. And there, their son is caught up, their daughter who died at 9 or 10. And the husband looks at the wife and he says, "There's Peter. There he is. He's resurrected." There's a husband caught up and he sees his bride perfect with her face glowing like they were first married. He put her in the grave. He was 86. She was 84. He put her in the grave there. They had the funeral. Now he sees her coming out in the flower of her youth. His body is transformed. And he sees her. He says, "Darling, there you are. You've come out more beautiful than ever." Oh, it's going to be so exciting. We look through that crowd. We see that son, that daughter, that husband, that wife. The last time we saw her was in a morgue, face all damaged from that car wreck and bloody, but now you see her whole again. The last time you saw him was a weak, emaciated, thin body dying of cancer, but now they come out of the grave and their faces are glowing and they're beautiful than ever before. And you say, "There is Alice, there is Jane, there is Pete, there is Harry." They come out of the grave alive. The Bible says, Revelation 22, verse 5, read it with me, please. "And they shall reign forever and ever and ever and ever through all eternity." Even in death, we can hold the hand of Christ, the Christ who lays our loved ones in the grave, the Christ who holds them close to his breast, the Christ who lets them rest, the Christ who has their identity in his mind, the Christ that's marked that tomb, the Christ that will resurrect them from the dead. The musician, Thomas Dorsey, not the jazz musician, the songwriter, the pianist, was living in the city of Chicago. A number of years ago, it was a cold, snowy night. His wife was pregnant for their first child. And he had a concert down in St. Louis. He was going to take the train down. His wife said, "Darling, please don't go. I may deliver the baby tonight. Please don't go." He said, "Honey, probably the baby's not going to come for the next 6 hours. I'll be back in 6 hours. Take the train down, do the concert, hop on the train, come back." He left. Immediately after the concert, he got a telegram. "You are the father of a proud, you're the proud father of a lovely, bubbly, cheerful baby boy. But we regret to inform you, your wife died in delivery." His heart was broken. He felt guilty and condemned himself. He got on the train, came back to Chicago, went up to the hospital. He got there. The doctors met him in the waiting room. The doctor reached out, embraced him, and said, "Mr. Dorsey, I'm sorry to tell you that your baby's son died half an hour ago." Thomas Dorsey went into a terrible, terrible blue funk of discouragement. He could never write again. He said, "I'll never write again. I'll never play the piano again." He went out to a little retreat outside of Chicago. A month went by, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months. Discouraged, disappointed. One day he sat down on the piano and began to play those keys. And as he played quietly, a song just seemed to come to his mind. He just began to play, and then he said, "Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on and help me stand. Through the dark and through the night, lead me on to the right. Precious Lord, take my hand." If you've lost a loved one in death, you can say tonight, "Precious Lord, take my hand. Precious Lord, give me that warmth. Give me that comfort. Give me that security. Precious Lord, help me to know that this loved one, as a believer, is safe and secure in your arms. Precious Lord, comfort my heart. Precious Lord, keep me looking for that day that Jesus will come and the dead will be resurrected." Why not right now? Bow your head and imagine this scene, that Christ comes, that the earth gives up its dead, the sky is illuminated with the glory of God, Why not right now imagine this scene? That the graves are open, that there's John or Mary or Harry or Sally, that there they are coming up out of the grave. Why not right now reach up and say, precious Lord, take my hand as John sings.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on and help me stand, for I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me on. When my way grows dreary, precious Lord, please linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, and hold my hand, lest I fall. Precious Lord, take my hand and lead me home.
Our ushers have a response card that they're going to pass out right now. And as they do, I want you to join John and sing that first verse, precious Lord, take my hand. Just now, ushers, would you pass across a response card? This card, I'll go over with you together, but let's sing that first verse as the card's going out. I'd like every person to get a card. Wherever you are across America, I'd like you to get a card. Every person in the Sequoia Conference Center, I'd like to get a card. Those of you who are here on the lights, I'd like you to turn the lights on for us, please. And let's sing this song with John. Precious Lord, take my hand, and then we'll go over the card together. Sing it together.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home.
This is ACN.
My topic tonight is Revelations, 1,000 Years of Peace. The Roaring Twenties were roaring indeed. Money was flowing. Wine was flowing. They were a time of, some would say, wine, women, and song. They were the Roaring Twenties. A time of bands and music, a time of alcohol, a time of fancy clothes and expensive cars, and everything seemed to be going right before that 1929 stock market crash in America. Roaring Twenties, look back at them today as a time of great excitement, great exhilaration for America. But as we look at that period of time, there's a story that comes out of the Roaring Twenties that is quite remarkable and indeed quite incredible. A woman whom I'll call Rose developed a fascinating disease, a sleeping sickness. She was not dead, but she went into a coma. When Rose went into her coma, the year was 1926. She began sleeping. She could not get out of the coma. She slept 1926, 1927, 1928, 1929. All through the 1930s, she slept. All through the 1940s, she slept. Through the 50s, she slept. She was in a coma from 1926 to 1966. 40 years. There was a very renowned American physician, and he began experimenting with a new medication that could help wake people up out of sleeping sickness. It was called Ladopa, L-A-D-O-P-A. And he administered it to her in 1966. After 40 years of being asleep, she woke up. When she did, it was so incredibly amazing. But in her mind, she thought that it was still 1926. She began singing the songs of the 1920s. She began doing the dances of the, I won't do them on the stage, she began doing the dances of the 1920s. Can you believe it? Her speech was as a woman in the 1920s. Now, unfortunately, after about 9 months of this, she began to go into a deep sleep again. Nothing the doctors could do could wake her out of that sleep, and she ultimately died. Hers was an awakening after years of sleep, and when she woke up, she had no sense at all that time had passed by. The scriptures describe another great awakening. This time when we wake up, we'll never go to sleep again. This time when we wake up, though, we will not be living in time. We will be living in eternity. The Bible writers begin to speak about that great awakening. John chapter 5, verse 28, Jesus speaks about it. He says this, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of damnation, of condemnation." How many resurrections does this Bible passage describe? How many? Two. What are they called? The resurrection of what? Life, and the resurrection of condemnation. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us when they exactly take place in this passage, but it does tell us that there are two resurrections. Every single one of us are destined to be in one of two resurrections, the resurrection of life or the resurrection of condemnation or damnation. The first resurrection is the resurrection of life. Jesus Christ comes, and men and women who've been sleeping in the tomb awake. They awake this time never to go to sleep again. They awake to see the face of Jesus Christ. They awake to see the glory of God. Here is some truck driver skidding on an icy, narrow mountain road. His truck goes off the road. It careens down a steep cliff. He's crushed and dead. The next thing he knows is not the screeching sound of the tires, not the sound of the breaking glass or the tumbling truck. The next thing he knows is the face of Christ. Here is a woman who has been diagnosed as having cancer. It's metastasized, going through her body. The next thing she knows is not the pain, not the chemotherapy, but the face of Christ. Here's a young man drafted into the service, goes into the army, is shot down over some enemy territory. His plane is on fire. The next thing he knows is not that plane going down, but the face of Christ. The Bible says, 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 16, read it with me, please. "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." The dead in Christ, when you and I close our eyes in that sleep of death in Christ. The next thing we know is the coming of Jesus. Death is not to be feared any more than a good, sound sleep. Our lives are hid with Christ in God. Jesus marks that grave. And the Bible continues with these words, "Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." So there's this glorious resurrection that occurs. And thus, 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 17, we shall always be with the Lord when Jesus Christ comes. There are only two classes, the saved and the lost. Those in the first resurrection and those destroyed by the brightness of Christ's coming. You see, there is no second chance when Jesus comes. That's why the Bible says, Revelation 20, verse 6, "Blessed and holy is he who has part in" what resurrection? The first resurrection. Just think of what it's going to be like. A father and mother who've lost a baby in death, and having that baby placed by the angel in the mother's arms again. Think of what it's going to be like. That little child dying at 3 or 4, coming up out of the grave, and the mother seeing it, the father seeing it, and embracing that child, and families being caught up in the air to meet Christ. You know, I've had some people say to me, even in this lecture series, they've said, "Look, Pastor, what if a person's married 2 times or 3 times? Whose wife, whose husband are they going to be in the resurrection?" Somebody said, "Yeah, I've been thinking about that question." You know, God doesn't give us the answer to every question, but he lets us know this. Heaven is going to be a place of such incredible love that that love fills our hearts and our love needs are met. And you know, the question isn't who she's going to be in the resurrection. That's not the question. The question really is, can I trust God enough that every need that I have, he will fulfill? Can I trust God enough to know that in heaven, he will bring it out all right? Isn't that the question? And when we are resurrected, there's a lot of questions that we can't figure out right now. And we could sit here and ask those questions all evening. But the one thing we know is this, that our hearts are made to love. We are not made to live in isolation. And when we are resurrected, God, with his great love, with his fountain of love, will meet every love need. And husbands and wives that are saved in some situations will have those love needs met with one another. In other ways, if God has some other mysterious way that I don't understand now for him to fill that love need, I'm willing to leave that with God. Aren't you, ladies and gentlemen? But I trust him enough to know that those needs will be met. Husbands, wives, fathers, mothers, sisters, brothers, united in Christ. The revelation of Jesus, though, describes that there's not only one class when Christ comes, not only that class that is resurrected to live with Jesus forever, not only that class of living, righteous believers that are changed immortally, that ascend through the sky with these glorious immortal bodies, never subject to disease or death, but the Bible describes a second class. It says, Revelation 6, verse 15, "The kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every free man hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains. And they said to the mountains and rocks, 'Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb.'" They continue, "For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand?" Now here is a different class. The first class look up and they say, "This is our Lord. We've waited for him and he'll save us." The first class look up, their hearts are beating with eager anticipation. They are longing for the coming of Christ as a bride does for her wedding day. They are longing for the coming of Christ as a husband does to watch that bride walk down the aisle. I mean, their hearts are beating with eager anticipation. They're excited about the coming of Jesus, but there is a second class. They look up and see him coming, and their hearts are filled with fear. Guilt makes men and women afraid, and when you're afraid, you run. You see, their guilty, sinful lives, they look up and see the holiness of God. They look up and see the righteousness of God. They look up and see Christ coming, and they begin to run. What a shame. What a tragedy. What a tragedy. This Christ that wants to save them. This Christ that wants to love them. This Christ that wants to take them to a new world with no sickness or suffering or sorrow or death, they run from him. They turn their backs on him. They have never crowned him as king of their hearts and lives now, so they do not accept him as king of the universe. And ladies and gentlemen, if Jesus Christ does not sit as king of your heart now, you will run in fear then. Your heart will be gripped with fear, because the holiness of God will consume you. But as you accept Jesus Christ as the king of your heart now, what does it mean to accept Jesus as king? It means to say, Lord, I'm not running my own life, you're running it. I'm not sitting on the throne of my own heart, you are. Lord, one day I want to look up and say, Jesus, you are my Lord and Savior, my King, my Redeemer. You see, Christ is not only our Savior, he's our Lord. Christ not only died for our sins, but he died so he could be the Lord of our hearts so that we can live different lives. I have seen God do so many amazingly incredible things in people's lives. I remember once I was speaking in Fitchburg, Massachusetts. And while I was speaking there in the Fitchburg Civic Center, a group of motorcycle gang guys came in. Every night, these guys would drive up on their Harley Davidsons. They'd get out with their black leather jackets and their gang symbols on, and they'd come into the meeting. As I was preaching every night, the gang leader, a guy by the name of Bucky. Now, Bucky was a tough guy, had been in and out of court 25, 26 times, Saturday night's entertainment, drink a bottle of beer, then break the bottle on a brick wall and go out and stick some people in the face for entertainment. You know, that was his Saturday night entertainment. I mean, this guy was a tough, tough guy. 6'3", 6'4", bearded guy, scars down his face. So he came into the meetings. And in the meetings, the Lord got a hold of his heart, and he was converted. Just gave his heart to Christ, and he and I became really good friends. And he'd come with his motorcycle up to the meetings, and he'd say, "How you doing, preach?" And he'd throw his arms around me, and I'd feel crack, crack. I'd say, "You know, I got to preach tomorrow night. Don't squeeze me so hard, Bucky." You know, but he was just a great guy. One night after one of the meetings, I was tired. This businessman was in the meeting. And he was really a tough guy, this businessman. I mean, you know, he always asking questions and that kind of snide remarks about the meetings. And he didn't like this, didn't like that. And he was an atheist, really didn't believe in God. He was kind of a short guy, about 5'2". So one night after the meeting, I was talking to Bucky. And we're talking, you know, and he's telling me what Christ means to his life and how Christ is the Lord of his life and Christ is the Lord of his heart. And this little guy comes up and he started needling me, you know. You know, how do you know there's a God? You know, how to... And after all of that, I just looked at Bucky and I said, "Bucky, take care of this guy, would you?" And the guy had no idea that Bucky and I were so close. And Bucky looked down at him and he said, "Mister, I want to tell you something. You better be thankful there is a God. Because if there was no God, my heart wouldn't be changed and I wouldn't be kind and loving. And if this were 3 weeks ago and you treated my friend Mark Finley like that, I'd take you out into the back alley. So, sir, you be thankful there is a God because my heart has been changed and I'm new and I'll just smile at you today, but go home and leave the man alone." You know, it was so incredible. You should have saw that little guy when I said to him, "Bucky, take care of this guy." I mean, he was like, you know, just about frozen there. Jesus Christ enters into our hearts and changes us. He becomes the king of our lives. When he comes again, the Bible says, 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 7, those that do not make Christ king of their life, to give you who are troubled rest with us. When the Lord Jesus Christ is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, doing what, everybody? Taking vengeance on those who do not know God, and on those who do not, what? Obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who is consumed? Those that don't make Christ the king of their life. Those that turn their back on Christ. Those that say obedience is unnecessary. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 8 says, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. So when Jesus comes, there are two classes, the saved and the lost. those that are resurrected from their grave, that are righteous and receive glorious immortal bodies, and along with the living believers are caught up to meet Christ in the sky. Those who are consumed with the brightness of his coming. Tonight, Jesus Christ invites you to make him your Lord, your Savior, your King. As we crown him King of Kings here, he reigns as our, in the universe as a King of Kings there. He comes again to redeem us. He comes again to take us up from this planet called Earth. That's why as we look around, we do not need to have our hearts be troubled. John 14, verse 1 says, "Let not your heart be troubled." Jesus is speaking. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus says, I will come again. Not maybe I'll come again, not I might come again, not perhaps I'll come again, not I'll think I'll come again, not it's highly likely I'll come again, not it's altogether possible I'll come again. What are the words of Jesus, everybody? Four words, I what? Will come again. Christ came once. How many of you believe Jesus was a historical figure, the divine Son of God? He came once. Can I see your hands? You believe Jesus came once. If he came once, he's coming again. But this time, not as a babe in Bethlehem's manger. This time, not as a child born of a virgin. This time, not to die on a cross, but to reign on a throne. Christ is coming again in the clouds of heaven. Revelation 19, verse 11, describes that scene. Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. Why white horse? It's symbolic of victory. And he who sat on him was called faithful and true. And in righteousness, he judges and makes war. So when Christ comes this time, it's the final judgment. The wicked are destroyed. The unbelievers are destroyed. Those who haven't accepted Christ as Savior and Lord are destroyed. In righteousness, he judges and, the Bible says, makes war. We continue. He had a name written that no one knew except he himself. His eyes were like a flame of fire. That's a symbol of judgment. And on his head were many crowns. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Who do you think the armies in heaven are? Who are those armies in heaven that come with Jesus? Who are they? Angels. That's right. 10,000 times 10,000 angels. So Jesus comes. Satan and his evil angels are going to be defeated. Satan and all the hosts of hell are going to be defeated. And the Bible says, now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations. What's the sharp sword that goes out of his mouth? Hebrews 4, verse 12 says, the word of God is like a sharp, two-edged sword. So at God's word, at God's presence, in the presence of the glory of God, the unrighteous, the unbelievers are consumed with the presence of Christ as he comes. Revelation 19, 15 says, and he himself will rule with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. It's the end time. Jesus comes. The wicked are destroyed. Revelation 19, 16. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So when Jesus comes, those who have crowned him king of their lives here worship him as king of the universe. You see, unless Jesus sits on the throne of your heart today, he will not sit on the throne of your heart then. Unless he sits on the throne of your heart now, he'll not sit on the throne of your heart then. Unless he is the Christ of the present, he won't be the Christ of the future. Jesus Christ invites you tonight to give your life to him, to say to him, Lord, I want you to be my king. And as my king, I am your loyal subject. Whatever you want me to do, Lord, I'm going to do it. Whatever you ask me to do, Lord, I'm going to do it. If you say, my body is your temple, I'm going to surrender anything, Lord, that stands between me and you. If you say the Bible Sabbath is Saturday, Lord, I'm going to keep it. Lord, whatever you ask me to do, not in my strength, not in my power, but because I love you and I want you to be my king, that's what I'm going to do, Lord. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, what events occur at Christ's coming? First, when Jesus comes, believers are resurrected. Secondly, when Christ comes, all believers, those resurrected and those living, receive immortality, a new glorious body. Thirdly, when Christ comes, there's nobody left alive on earth. We've read the Bible text, 2 Thessalonians 1 verse 9, 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 8, all wicked living are consumed with the brightness of Christ's coming. Fourthly, the wicked dead remain in their graves. They are not yet resurrected. The resurrection of the righteous is the first resurrection. Nextly, the believers ascend to heaven with Christ. Now, there are some questions that Christians ask, and here are the questions that they ask. They say, what happens after Christ comes? They ask, what's the condition of the earth when believers are caught up to meet Christ in the air? What happens to Satan at this time? Is he destroyed? Is he left on earth? When does God make the earth new? What did Jesus mean when he said he's going to create a new heaven and a new earth in 2 Peter 3? What did Jesus mean when he said the meek shall inherit the earth? When does that happen? Is there anyone alive on earth during what the Bible calls the 1,000 years? These questions have good answers, and we're going to explore them tonight from the book of Revelation. In Revelation 19, it describes Christ as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In Revelation 19, it describes Christ coming on that horse symbolically with the victory of the earth. But in Revelation 20, verse 1, after the coming of Christ, the next scene that John sees, the next vision that John has, then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for a what? For a what? 1,000 years. Now, this is where many Bible students get the term millennium. The word millennium is not found in the Bible. The word millennium is not used in the Bible. It comes from two Latin words, milli and annium, meaning 1,000 years. And this text that we've just read, that Satan would be bound 1,000 years, is where many Bible students get the word millennium. Now notice it says that Satan is cast in the abyss. What's this abyss that Satan is cast into? It says he's cast into the bottomless pit. Now, the Greek language is the language of the New Testament, and it's the word abusos, abusos. Can you say that? I'll teach a Greek word tonight of the Bible. Let's say it together. Abusos. Well, that was pretty good. My Greek teacher would have passed you on that, but let's try it once again. What is it? Abusos. That means abyss. What does that mean? How's that word used in the Bible? You remember in the beginning of Genesis, in Genesis 1, 2, where it says the earth was without form and void? It says the earth was an abusos, an abyss, a desolate place. Throughout the Bible, when the Bible uses the term without form and void to describe a desolate earth, it uses the word abusos. This word abyss is not some deep subterranean cavern. When Christ comes the second time, every mountain and island is moved out of its place. When Christ comes the second time, every building is crashed down. When Christ comes the second time, the righteous living and the righteous dead are resurrected to meet Christ in the air. When Christ comes the second time, the wicked living are consumed with the brightness of Christ's coming, unbelievers are destroyed, and the unbelievers stay in their grave. So when Christ comes the second time, the earth is desolate like an abyss, like it was when God spoke the earth into creation and it was without form and void in Genesis. So the bottomless pit is the abyss. Now, what are these chains that bind Satan? Remember, the Bible says he would be bound or chained for a what? 1,000 years. Does God come down and put handcuffs on Satan? What kind of chains are these? The Bible tells you very clearly. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. For if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and deliver them into what? Chains of what? Darkness, to be reserved for judgment. So during the 1,000 years, Satan is bound or chained on earth with chains of darkness. He is chained in the sense that he's confined to this desolate planet. He's chained in the sense that during the 1,000 years, there is no one to tempt. Now remember, Satan said to Eve, "Eve, if you eat this tree, you'll have life and you will not have death." Remember, Satan said to the angels in heaven, "If you follow me, you'll have joy and happiness." But during the 1,000 years, why doesn't Christ just come and make earth new? Everything God does is to ensure the safety of the universe for millions of years. It's to ensure the security of the universe for billions of years. God is handling the sin problem in a way that is not some quick fix solution. God desires that sin never raise its ugly head up again. And for that to happen, at least two things must happen. The entire universe, cherubim and seraphim and angel beings and human beings on earth, must know that God is a God of incredible love and worthy to be trusted. That's why Jesus came, to show that God so loved the world, that he's this God of incredible love and you can trust him, that this God will go to any lengths to save you. He'll go to any depths to pull you out of the pit. He'll do anything. That's one half of the coin. The other half of the coin is that this great controversy between good and evil can never be settled unless the whole universe sees how bad sin is, sees how wicked sin is, and Satan will wander around among the dead bodies of the wicked. He'll wander around on a dark earth. He'll wander around among broken cities and broken down society. And echoing and re-echoing throughout the universe will be the words, "The wages of sin are death, the wages of sin are death." As the entire heavenly universe looks at earth, they will see, this is what life is like without God. This is what life is like when Satan is on the loose. Is there anyone alive on earth during the millennium? Well, only Satan and his angels. The Bible says, Jeremiah 4:20, verse 23, "I beheld the earth, and it was without form and void." Wait a minute. This is not at creation. This is when Jesus comes the second time. "And the heavens, and they had no light. I beheld the mountains, and indeed they trembled. And all the hills moved back and forth." When are the mountains going to tremble and the hills move back and forth, everybody? When's that? When Jesus comes the second time, every mountain and island moved out of its place. Jeremiah 4:25, read it together. Jeremiah 4, verse 25, reading together. "I beheld, and indeed there was..." How many people lived on earth? No man. Some people have the strange idea that we live on earth during the millennium. My Bible says that we're received with Christ and go to the new earth, go to the heavenly temple. We don't live on earth. "I beheld, and indeed there was no man, and all the birds of the heavens had fled. I beheld, and indeed the fruitful land was a wilderness." You see, this is not a creation. This is a time when the fruitful land, earth, becomes a wilderness, a desolate place after Jesus comes. "And all its cities were" what? "Broken down." When were they broken down? At the what? Presence of the Lord by his fierce anger. And what happens on earth during this time? Jeremiah says, chapter 4, verse 27, "For thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be desolate, yet I will not make a full end." Why won't he make a full end? Because out of the ashes of this old world, God is going to create a new world. Out of all this desolation, out of all this destruction, God will create a new heavens and a new earth, and the holy city will come down upon it, and we'll live here forever in this new heavens and a new earth. Jeremiah 25, verse 33 says, "And at that day, the slain of the Lord..." Who's the slain of the Lord? The wicked, who've been destroyed by the brightness of his coming, the unbelievers. "The slain of the Lord shall be from one end of the earth even to the other end of the earth." And it goes on. "They shall not be lamented." What's the word lamented mean? Who can tell me? What's lamented? "They won't be mourned or sorrowed over. Why won't they be mourned or sorrowed over? Because the righteous are in heaven, all the wicked are destroyed, so they won't be lamented, sorrowed over. There's nobody to sorrow over them, or gathered, or buried. Why not buried? Because they were destroyed with the brightness of Christ coming. They shall become refuse on the ground. The Bible says, the slain of the Lord from one end of the earth to the other. And as Satan wanders around over the earth, as he sees these dead bodies, Satan will hear echoing in his head, the wages of sin is death, the wages of sin is death, death, separation from God brings death. A planet in rebellion brings death, it brings sorrow, it brings disappointment. And the righteous will say, Lord, we trust you, yours is the way of life, Satan's is the way of death. Love brings life, selfishness brings death. And here, the Bible says in Revelation 20, verse 6, blessed and holy is he who has part in what resurrection? The first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. What a passage. The Bible describes it. It says that the wicked dead are in their graves, the wicked living are destroyed. But it says the righteous, the believers, are priests of God, and they reign with Christ for 1,000 years. What are we doing in that reign with Christ? And I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was committed onto them. Never sell your soul cheap. There are only two ways, the way of life and the way of death. During the millennium, either the unbelievers, the wicked, are in their graves, or they're destroyed with the brightness of Christ coming, and their corpses are on the earth, or righteous believers are in heaven with Christ, reigning with him on thrones, part of the royal family of the universe, part of God's royal line of believers in the universe. You are a prince or a princess. To sell out for money is to sell out cheap. To sell out for lust is to sell out cheap. To sell out for greed is to sell out cheap. To sell out for the popularity of other people is to sell out cheap. During the millennium, God has a destiny for you. To reign on a throne with him through all eternity. The Bible says that during this time in Revelation 20, verse 12, the books were open. And you say, I don't quite understand that. What does this have to do? Why is it that during the 1,000 years after the lost are lost, there are certain books that are opened? There's a drama between good and evil. There's a drama between Christ and Satan. And during the 1,000 years, the redeemed will be able to look over all of the records of life. And let's suppose you're in heaven, and there's somebody that you expect to be there, but you don't see them there. A husband, a wife, a son or daughter, a friend. And you say, God, I don't know why they're lost. They were the nicest person. God, why were they lost? For that lingering doubt to remain in your mind, you might have complete confidence in God. But if you do not have that explained to you, there may be some doubt in the future. So what God does during that 1,000 years, he says, my children, heaven's books are open. Heaven's books are not closed. I'm a God of open fairness. I'm a God of justice. You ask me about John. You ask me about Mary. You ask me about Todd. You ask me about Raylene. But look, here's the record. I sent my Holy Spirit to them there. I appealed to him in love there. I sent this book to their home. I had them turn into this TV program. I sent this neighbor to their home. I sent Christ to die for them. I did everything that I could. I impressed them not once, but thousands and thousands of times. And when we look over those records, we'll fall on our knees and tears will run down our face. And we'll say, Lord, you did everything you could to save John and Mary. And God will look at us and he'll say, my heart is broken. I wanted to save them, but they wouldn't let me. I kept calling them and they kept turning their back on me. They were in light, and they kept walking into the darkness and into the darkness. They were in light and went into the darkness. I wanted them to be in light. I didn't want them to go in darkness. I didn't want them to turn their back on me. In heaven during the 1,000 years, before Christ has the holy city descend at the end of the 1,000 years, before he creates a new heaven and a new earth, up there in that new Jerusalem temple, Christ himself will explain to us why some people aren't there. He'll explain to us what was going on in their heart, that hatred, that bitterness, why they couldn't be there, why they wouldn't be happy in heaven. Because heaven is a place of unselfishness. Heaven is a place of love. Heaven is a place of giving and sharing. Heaven is a place of total commitment to Christ. Heaven is a place when Christ reigns on your heart. And there, sitting on those thrones with Christ, the Bible says, 1 Corinthians 6, verse 2, read it with me, please. Do you not know that the saints, that's believers, will judge the world? We participate in that final judgment. And at the end of those 1,000 years, when wicked are finally destroyed, we say, Christ, your verdict is right. Your verdict is right. Do you not know that we shall judge what? Angels. We participate in the judgment of Satan and the evil angels and the wicked. The Bible makes that plain. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 5. Therefore, judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the hearts. Then each one's praise will come from God. During the 1,000 years, he brings to light the hidden things of the darkness. He brings to light the things that have been in human hearts. He settles for us issues of destiny. So what goes on during those 1,000 years? During the 1,000 years, first, the righteous are in heaven. During the 1,000 years, the wicked remain dead. During the 1,000 years, Satan and his angels are bound on earth. During the 1,000 years, the earth remains desolate. During the 1,000 years, the wicked are desolate across the earth. Now, what events happen after the millennium? This is the most exciting drama in the history of the universe. This is more exciting than any Star Wars drama. This is more exciting than any cheap, fictitious tale produced by Hollywood. This is the drama of the ages. This is the drama that settles the divine destiny between good and evil. What events happen at the end of the millennium? The wicked dead are resurrected at the end of the millennium. All of them are resurrected at the end of the 1,000 years. Look at it. Here it is. Revelation 20, verse 5. But the rest of the dead, who's the rest of the dead? Those who were not in the first resurrection. Those that were not caught up with Christ. The unbelievers. But the rest of the dead, read it with me, please, did not live again until the 1,000 years were what? Finished. And how large is this number? The Bible tells us, Revelation 20, verse 8. The number is as the sand of the sea. Millions of them lost. Jesus wanted to save them. Jesus reached out to them to save them. But they're resurrected now. And what happens when they're resurrected? Revelation 20, verse 7. Now when the 1,000 years have expired. What's another word for expired? What's that? Finished. That's right. The 1,000 years are what? Finished. Satan is released from his prison. He was chained on earth in darkness with nobody to tempt. Now he is released because the wicked dead have been resurrected at the end of the 1,000 years, and he can go out to tempt them. So what does it say? He will go out to deceive the nations that are in the four corners of the earth. Satan senses, this is my army. These are my followers. And Satan rallies these evil forces. Satan says, we can take God. This is our last chance. We can throw God off the throne. This is our last chance. You'd think if they came up at the end of the 1,000 years, and some of them, the wicked who had been living before the 1,000 years and were destroyed by the brightness of Christ's coming, you would think that they would say, yes, indeed, we want to be saved. You'd think if they were destroyed by the brightness of Christ's coming that they would be on their knees just begging God for forgiveness. But there's something about the mind that rebels against God. There's something about the heart that rebels against God. There's something about the inner person whose life is steeled against God. They come up. Satan goes out to deceive them now. He rallies them. And all the host of the lost, all the unnumbered brilliant men and women, unbelievers of all ages are there. The wicked are there. They're on earth. And what begins to happen in this exciting drama, Revelation 21, verse 2, that I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. What does John see? He says, I looked up in the sky. On earth were the wicked with Satan. And in heaven, there's this holy city coming down from God out of heaven. Where's it going to? Revelation 21, verse 3. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, what kind of a voice, everybody? What kind of voice was it? A loud voice. Here is an angelic voice that announces to the whole universe. Here is an angelic voice that announces to unfallen worlds. Here is a loud voice that announces to planets in distant realms of space afar. Here is a loud voice that announces to cherubim and seraphim and angelic beings. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is where? With men, and he will dwell with them. Righteous believers are inside the city as it descends. And they shall be his people. God himself will be where? With them and be their God. The holy city is descending. And believers are inside that city. Unbelievers are outside that city. Ladies and gentlemen, you and I are either going to be in the city or out of the city. When that city descends, we are either in it with Christ in that final drama. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. He is our King. He is our Captain. He is our victorious General. He is our glorious leader. He is our Christ. We're with him in that city. That city begins to descend, but Satan the deceiver, Satan the destroyer, Satan who has manipulated minds, Satan who's played selfish games with the minds of men and women, Satan who's led them to disobey God, Satan who's led them to crown themselves as Lord of their own hearts, he stirs them up. And those wicked, those unbelievers begin to race up on that city. The Bible says, Revelation 20, verse 9, they, the wicked, the unbelievers, went up on the breadth of the earth. They surrounded the camp of the saints. The holy city hovers over the earth. It's coming down, and as it's coming down, they run up to surround it. They surround the camp of the saints and the beloved city. And the Bible says, Revelation 20, verse 9, and fire came down from God out of heaven and what? Devoured them. It devours them. It consumes them. They're gone. And the Bible says, before this happens, Revelation 20, verse 11, then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it. This is the great white throne judgment. At this last final judgment, every human being sees their life go before them. Every one of the wicked. See, during the 1,000 years, the righteous believers know exactly why God couldn't save these unbelievers. They know exactly that God is just. Right at the end, at this great white throne judgment, what happens? All these wicked, for those who faced the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great. That's the dead who've been resurrected, the wicked dead, small and great, standing before God. The books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. Before these wicked unbelievers are destroyed, they see their whole life go before them. They see that God tried to save them. They see that the book of life of the Lamb has provided salvation for them. And even then, you know, Paul says in Philippians 2 that every tongue shall confess and every knee shall bow that Jesus Christ is Lord. Believers and unbelievers unite in one chorus of praise because even the unbelievers say, Christ is right. We deserve to be destroyed forever because our hearts are too rebellious against him. He's right. His judgments are right. I don't deserve to live. I deserve to die and be gone forever. And their rebellious hearts, that's not a confession. It's not an acknowledgement of who God is. It's an acknowledgement of who they are. Because even if he saved them at that point, they'd still be more rebellious. It's not an acknowledgement of who God is. It's an acknowledgement of the sinfulness of their own heart and that God did everything he could to save them. They're rebellious inside. They're rebellious to the core. There's no changing them now. And the Bible says the dead were judged according to their works by the things that were written in those books. And the holy city descends, and that holy city fills the earth. Sin and sinners are no more. God creates a new heaven, and God creates a new earth. Revelation 21, verse 1 says, "Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth." We see it before our eyes. Can you imagine what that is going to be like, ladies and gentlemen? Can you imagine it? Just being there, like when God created the earth and he carpeted it with living green. He planted fruit trees and flowers. We're there in that holy city hovering over the earth, and God creates a new Garden of Eden, but this time it's the whole earth. God creates a new Eden, and it's this old earth made new. Isn't that like God? He takes old polluted atmosphere and makes it pure. Takes the old polluted rivers and brooks and streams and makes them new. He creates a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away. Also, there was no more sea. What does it mean, no more sea? Well, sea is the symbol of separation. Lakes, rivers, our hearts are never separated anymore. Never separated from our loved ones. Never separated from those that are near and dear to us. Never separated from those that mean a lot to us. The Bible says, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 10, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up." And the Bible goes on, and it says, here are the events at the end of the millennium. At the end of the millennium, Christ and the saints and the city descend. At the end of the millennium, the wicked dead are raised. At the end of this thousand-year period, Satan is loosed. Satan attacks the holy city. At the end of the millennium, the last judgment occurs. The wicked see their deeds and see why God cannot save them. At the end of the millennium, Satan is thrown into the lake of fire. He's destroyed. The sinners are thrown into the lake of fire. They are destroyed. At the end of the millennium, the earth is cleansed. The earth is made new. One pulse of harmony and gladness beats throughout the vast creation. There is love in the air. There are songs of joy. There's great celebration. There's songs of worthy, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive riches and honor and power and glory forever. The night of sin is over. The night of sorrow is over. The night of tears is over. The night of war and tragedy and disappointment is over. There's happiness and gladness and joy through all the land. Cherubims praise him. Seraphims praise him. Angelic beings praise him. His people praise him because they sense that this is eternity. This is forever. Peter cries out, Revelation cries out, 2 Peter 3, verse 13, "Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells." We're looking for a new heaven and a new earth. Sin will never rise up a second time. Sin will never contaminate this earth again. There never will be rebellion again. We have crowned him King of Kings. We've crowned him Lord of Lords. He's the Savior of our souls and the King of our hearts. And through all eternity, we dance through eternity with Jesus, filled with joy, filled with gladness, filled with happiness. At his feet, we worship him as King. I remember when I was in the fifth grade, I raised my hand once and I asked my teacher, I said, "Teacher, teacher, how long is eternity?" And my teacher looked at me. Now, I was brought up in New England, state of Connecticut, on the east coast of America, brought up with those great New England beaches. And as a boy, I remember running down the beach, sand coming up between my toes, wind blowing in my hair, diving into that salt water. I love the salt breeze. I love those little New England dinghies, those little motorboats, Long Island Sound. That's the memories of my childhood, the smell of the salt water, the smell of seaweed. Oh, I love that perfume smell of that seaweed, you know. Oh, my. I remember I was in the fifth grade. I raised my hand. I said, "Teacher, I've got a question. Teacher, I'm confused about something. How long is eternity? How long is eternity?" Teacher thought for a moment, and she said, "Mark, picture the ocean." I pictured the vastness of the ocean. pictured, I remember times I'd go out with my dad, a granddad, and we'd be out in the ocean, and we couldn't even see land out there, 2 miles, 3 miles out in Long Island Sound, couldn't see land. I pictured ocean every place I could see. She said, picture a seagull. That wasn't hard. I'd pictured hundreds of seagulls flapping all around. She said, now this one seagull comes, and it takes a drop of water from the ocean with its beak and flies away. It doesn't come back for 100 years. It's an old seagull. Comes back and takes another drop and flies away. 100 years later, Mark, the seagull comes back and takes another drop and flies away. 100 years later, it takes another drop and flies away. Now, son, by the time the ocean gets dry, that's the first second of eternity, like the blinking of an eye. That is the first second of eternity. Bird coming once every 100 years, taking a drop and leaving. Bird coming once every 100 years, taking a drop and leaving. That's the first second of eternity when the ocean gets dry. I was in the fifth grade, and that made such an impression on me. I said, God, if that's eternity, I've got to be there with you. The only thing worth it is living with you, rejoicing with you. The only thing worth it, sin is not worth it. Because at the end, anyway, every knee is going to confess and every tongue is going to proclaim that he's Lord. Because we will see then that he was right and that our ways were rebellious. Why not acknowledge him now as king? Why not acknowledge him now as Savior? Why not be a part of that group that through all eternity will be filled with love and joy and happiness around his throne? Why not be part of that group that Jesus will say, welcome home, children. Welcome home, children. This is your home. Earth is not your home. This is your home. This is eternity. This is your home. Deep within my heart, I long for home. I long for eternity. I long for his arms to embrace me. I long to know his love. I long to hear his voice one day say, welcome home, children.
A great day is coming, heaven's gates will open wide, and all who love the Lord will enter in, and joined with our loved ones who in Jesus Christ have died, our eternal life in heaven will begin. And the Lord himself will greet us. Oh, what joy we'll feel that day, when with the smile of the proudest father, he looks at us to say, welcome home, children. This is the place I've prepared. Welcome home, children. This is faithfully. Welcome home, children. Welcome home, children. Here where I am, you will always be. Forever rejoicing, forever rejoicing, forever rejoicing with me.
Amen. Are you looking forward to that day when Jesus says, welcome home, children? If you are, wherever you are tonight, say, amen.
Amen.
Say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Welcome home, children. What a joy when that gate swings open and we walk through into that city of God. Nothing is worth missing that glorious invitation. Welcome home, children. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that it's a reality. We thank you that one day you'll throw your arms around us and say, my child, welcome home. And one day our hearts will sense it. One day our minds will know it. One day our spirits will feel it. That it's heaven, that it's eternity, that it is home. Thank you, O Father, that we can be there with you forever and ever. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now remember, tomorrow night, the love of God in the lake of fire. We've got to deal with that. It's in the book of Revelation. Probably tomorrow night will be the most responsible way that you have ever in your life heard this whole idea of hell dealt with. It is a way that you can explain to your children, you can explain it to your friends. It is clear, it's logical, it's concise, and it, most of all, it's biblical, directly from the Bible. Don't miss tomorrow evening's presentation. Bring a friend. It's a good night to bring somebody. Look forward to seeing you then. Tonight, you're tuning in ticket number what? Some said 15, some said 16. What is it? 16. Okay, there we go. And if you've been here 15 nights, if this is your 16th night, be sure to pick up your Bible on the way out tonight. Our hostesses have them. If for some reason you don't have it in your local area, speak about that to your host or hostess. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow night. Thank you for coming, and God bless you.